I don't mind. Real world.
All right, we are live on the web. Web audience, meet studio audience. Studio audience, meet the web audience. Feel free to clap from home or your desk at work, however that however weird that might feel. We got a good audience. We're primed and ready. This audience is not on Twitter. This audience is just focused on us. You can do a bunch of things at the same time. But I have no doubt that today's show is going to be very entertaining. With every day, the stakes get raised, and it gets more and more intense. I just look in Jody's eyes. He's like, stakes? What stakes? I like that.
It's like, stay awake, sorry.
I love me.
Yeah, yeah. Think about that trip to the Serengeti that you were promised by M.G. Vasanji.
Serengeti?
Was it not?
I thought it was the Taj Mahal.
It was either or. I think
that's
he said
even
here.
Near the Serengeti.
I know, but remember the lion chase? He goes either the Taj Mahal or the Serengeti to see a lion. He didn't really suggest what would be happening.
I think that would be up to the lion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there's lions at the zoo.
Yeah, but not Serengeti.
And there's no Taj Mahal at the zoo, so you could definitely. Well, you put in your request, you know, you let him know.
We'll see. We'll see what happens on Thursday.
You were getting a drink. I believe your author was going to get
old-fashioned.
You a smoked old-fashioned.
Several old-fashioned.
Several drinks.
She amended it to as many as I wanted.
Right. Chantal was getting food and drinks and then something fun, as though those things aren't fun enough.
Yes.
Candy, what were you going to get?
I was going to the Arctic.
What was that?
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Oh, you were getting, oh I'm sorry, Candy, Arctic. You were getting food and drinks and then something fun.
Which you'll still
get. You were getting a performance, Chantal. You kind of had to work, in a way, you could say, which is...
But do you know what? Just to tell you a quick little story. When I met my wife 17 years ago, she's a massive Chantal Kravyazik fan. I bought tickets for my wife to see Chantal within the first 3 days that I met her. She was playing two nights. I picked the wrong night. She didn't play Denise's favorite song, but she blew her away 17 years later. I'm still married to her.
Because
so I thank Chantal
concert.
For the
Chantal
love of my life.
Cemented right, so by not so playing the song that was the favorite.
That's
somehow
right.
You cemented
what
this
was the
marriage.
Favorite?
Green Apples.
And go.
Oh, okay.
You played it on the second night, but you didn't play it on the first. But now
cotton it's... candy. There it is.
Oh, I hope your wife's watching on the web.
I'm not kidding. Candy word, right?
Denise was at home
double
right now.
Double rainbows.
I literally watched Chantal go into her Rolodex. Like, I watched her eyes go up and go, I know that song from here, here, here.
And by the
yes,
way,
and
it's
go.
Like the crack amazing. Of ass in L.A. right now. And for her to sing that well that early
that
is
was
so
beautiful.
Yeah. Crack of ass means early, by the
it's
way.
Early.
I'm not sure if the kids are familiar with that term.
It's Nova Scotia early.
Humble, the gift to you was going to be something
or
that
mine.
Is... I mean, you can't even put a price on it.
It's
literally
it's
because
fun.
It costs nothing. Admiration. You were going to get admiration.
Which I apparently didn't get before.
Yeah, I know.
You
came off as the guy who has everything, so what do you buy the guy who has everything? So that's
some more.
Yeah,
some
more of everything?
Yeah.
I mean, set.
You and Andre Alexis have to have a little bit of a discussion about that, I think.
You have to have everything in every time zone.
That's okay.
I think
so you
like
tell him to take care of Pacific, mm-hmm. and you'll be good with Atlantic.
I agree.
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you mean, admiration in different time zones?
You just have, if he thinks he has everything, then just tell him to get him a second set in another time zone.
I live in two cities. I need two of everything, right?
Oh, I love it.
It'll save
I love
having
it.
To travel it back and explain to customs why
who
I have so much admiration
think,
in my suitcase.
Exactly. And you live in two cities that both have very high rent, so...
I know. He must
Andre.
Be loaded.
Super
loaded with admiration.
Loaded with admiration.
And the dog shirts, that's got to be setting him back, those dog shirts every day.
Shout out to Sandy for the dog shirt.
I mean, that should at least been, you know, co-purchased by Andre.
That
good shirts with the words dogs? Now you got another shirt
with a dog
invoice, on it?
You sent
him
the invoice, yes? For the dog
shirts. I have to find the invoice.
Okay, we have 20 seconds till we go to air, just to let everybody know. I'm sure you heard Kevin speak out loud. Why wouldn't you know that? What kind of dog is that one? Is that one of the 15?
I believe it's a Chihuahua. I believe when I purchased it, I thought it was a Corgi.
Yeah.
I believe there was a Corgi in the book, then I realized it was also not a Corgi in the book.
Yeah.
So it was just a lot of... It was pretty much the only dog decal at the store.
I'm Misha Brugger-Gosman, opera singer and Canada Reads panelist.
This is Chantal Kreviazic. I'm a singer, songwriter, humanitarian.
My name is Humble the Poet. I am an MC, spoken word artist, and author.
Think about it now. Don't speak about it, be about it, be about it now.
I'm Candy Palmiter, comedian, broadcaster, and recovered lawyer.
I'm Jody Minnick. I'm a veteran, an author, and a politician.
Hello, and welcome to Canada Reads. I'm your host, Ali Hassan. It's day two of CBC's Battle of the Books.
This is Canada Reads, Canada's annual title fight.
All right, well, yesterday was a dramatic day. The debates ranged from lively to tense. And then at the end, we voted, as we do on every show except our final one. When we have a winner. Chantal voted against Company Town. Jody and Misha both voted against The Break. And Humble and Candy both voted against The Right to be Cold. And that meant there was a tie, and Chantal had to break it. And since she was defending The Right to be Cold, she really didn't have a choice in the matter. She was forced to eliminate The Break. Now, Candy, I'd like to give you 1 minute to say goodbye to The Break.
Yesterday, it leaned so far right in here. I was feeling like it was 1968 and I was debating William F. Buckley. But alas, James Baldwin and Gore Vidal survived that, and so will I. The really good news is that last night, there was feminist talk all over the internet. Katrina Vermette, the author of The Break, got all kinds of love. And hashtag The Break and at The Candy Show, which is my Twitter handle, was trending on Twitter in Canada. And people were sending out pictures of them buying the book. Like, I had borrowed a copy, but now I'm going out to buy one to show the support. So I'm hoping this is going to be like The Inconvenient Indian, and that 3 years from now, this amazing book will still be on the bestsellers list.
All right, we hope so too. Candy, you are now a free agent, so your vote still counts. So you guys, Chantal, Jody, Misha, Humble, maybe you want to be on Candy's good side today. That's that depends on your own personal strategies.
You mean with those beautiful earrings?
Yeah. Oh, gorgeous.
Humble, on the way, on the way. Had that one in the pocket. All right, let's talk about the four titles that are still in the running. Company Town, Nostalgia, 15 Dogs, and The Right to be Cold. Today, you're going to hear from the authors who wrote those books. And then the panelist who is defending that author's book will have 30 seconds, again, 30 seconds, to make their opening statement. All right. Now, we're going to, Jody, you're going to be up first. You're defending Nostalgia. So let's hear a description from the author, M.G. Vasanji.
The book is set in a futuristic Toronto and looks at a world in which we can live long lives, 120, 150 years or even longer, where age does not matter and people live with renewed body parts and renewed or new memories. What might happen to a mind when old memories leak out and assert themselves? It has to be fixed.
So, you know, books mean so many things to so many people, but almost everybody wants a great read, and that's how we're going to start today. Jody, I'm going to give you 30 seconds. What right. makes Nostalgia a great book?
Nostalgia is a great book because MG actually took about 15 years to write it, so he actually started it before the age of social media. And what I really enjoyed about it is that race and identity kind of became a side note. It became almost a fashion accessory in certain ways. But it shows the possible plan ahead of how our world will develop with using social media for everybody's identity. And
that is time.
All
right. Chantal, you're next. You are defending The Right to be Cold. Here is Sheila Watt-Cloutier describing her memoir.
The Right to be Cold is a memoir. It is trying to put the human story, the human face, to what most Canadians and others around the world understand to be more of a scientific, economic, political issue. And that's the issue of climate change.
Chantal, you have 30 seconds. What makes The Right to be Cold a great book?
The Right to be Cold is a great book because it's relatable to people of all ages, and it is autobiographical. It's a call to action at a time when we have, you know, today the Trump administration has put the hammer down on all support of the environment. It's more important than ever that we become educated about it. Kids can read it. It's not violent, it's not explicit, and it's for future, it's for our future generation.
Okay. Thank you, Chantal. Humble, it's your turn. You're defending 15 Dogs. Here is a description from the author, Andre Alexis.
15 Dogs is a look at some essential aspects of what it is to be human. The way we think, the way we interact in the world, our ideas of power, our ideas of love, and just the varied ways that we have of thinking.
Humble, 30 seconds are on the clock. What makes 15 Dogs a great book?
15 Dogs is a great book because all of these great books discuss issues, and what is the root of every single issue? It's us. And as Sun Tzu said, know thy enemy. To best know ourselves, 15 Dogs does an amazing job of helping us both understand the world outside of us and the world inside of us and connecting those dots so we can actually understand how we got to the point that we're at right now with every single one of these issues.
All right, Misha, you were last today. You're defending Company Town. Here is Madeline Ashby describing her book.
Company Town is a murder mystery set on an oil rig off the coast of Newfoundland in the future. It takes place after the end of the oil bubble, and it's about a woman who protects a boy who is receiving death threats from the future.
Okay, Misha, 30 seconds. What makes Company Town a great book?
Company Town is great because it subverts the traditional dialogue surrounding literature to include a broader audience, a younger audience. With Madeline Ashby, we have a new and original female voice in Canadian science fiction. Company Town outlines the perils and blessings of a future where science and technology advance in partnership with a crown corporation. It's a multi-generational dialogue we should be having about the future we want for Canada. It has a diverse cast reflecting a diverse country.
Thank you very much, Misha. All right, well, there you have it. The four remaining contenders, Misha Brugger-Gossman defending Company Town, Jody Mittick defending Nostalgia, Humble, the poet, defending 15 Dogs, and Chantal Kreviazik defending The Right to be Cold. Candy Perlmutter was defending The Break, which was eliminated yesterday. I'm Ali Hassan. This is Canada Reads on CBC Radio 1 and Sirius XM, and it is time to debate. Let's get to it. All right, yesterday, Misha argued that in order to heal Canada, we have to include the entire nation. So, Candy, I want to ask you, which remaining book, other than your own, is the most inclusive?
I think The Right to be Cold is definitely the most inclusive book in terms of, while Sheila starts with a memoir, which, by the way, that might seem disjointed when you are reading memoir and then suddenly you're reading some factual information. But from an Indigenous perspective, we never speak publicly without first giving some biographical information. That is part of our way of speaking, so no surprise that that would be how she would choose to write. But fundamentally, what she is talking about is the environment, the planet that each and every one of us live on. So it doesn't matter what your gender, what your race, what your binary, what your socioeconomic category, we all are in trouble if we don't figure out what's wrong with this planet.
Okay, Jody, what would you say about that?
Actually, the first thing that popped into my head was exactly what she was saying. You can't get any less inclusive than an issue that affects the entire planet. And I think The Right to be Cold, actually, despite its it's the, you know, the story that it is and how tough it was for me to read, the message is still very real. We are living on a planet that is changing daily, and our generation or our kids are the ones that are going to be dealing with this, building walls to protect cities, trying to relocate entire nations. There's island nations that are going underwater. This is real stuff that we're going to have to deal with, and 100% of the right to be cold is that message, and that's the, and it's the, as Chantel has told us, it's the call to action.
Chantel, your book is being propped up quite positively right now in a turn of events for Canada Reads. But anything that you'd like to add to that?
Well, you know, I'd like to say that, first of all, Jody, you know, I want to extend my heartfelt apology. I don't feel that I was prepared. Maybe it is the Métis in me, but I was not quite prepared to be competitive. Not on this show. I don't like to be competitive, and particularly with something as important as the topic of climate change and Sela's book. And so I'd like to apologize. I think I was just, it was the first time that somebody had come, you know, was doing their job and being critical of the book.
That's okay. I thank you
for understanding that for me it was just me trying to be, you know, do my job and defend the book. And I know that you're an amazing human. A very inspiring human. And I think that
he's getting uncomfortable.
Back to me.
Well, Chantel, I appreciate
you are,
that. You're in LA, your son is ill. And you know, we're doing something that we really believe in here. So don't worry, I didn't take it that personally.
Yeah, we're starting Canada Reads with apologies and compliments to each other. I mean, Twitter is gonna be very upset about this. This is not the same
model.
Let me just very quickly. But very quickly, guys, all the love that Sela puts in her book and the inspiration she gives to everyone by educating us, yes, and that text is a bit heady and it's a bit intense, but that just shows the amount of sacrifice, the labor, it's real stuff. And I think that at the end of the day, those notes, that text is what empowers us to know the work that lies ahead for the world and for the future generation.
Okay.
So I think that the inspiring theme here is not only for the sake of literature, but it's for the sake of that call to action, of that move forward. And that's why this book is really important.
Okay, thank you for that, Chantel. The question that I had originally asked was, which book is the most inclusive? Misha, can I ask you that, other than your own book, which book do you find the most inclusive in this?
Well, I think it's hard because I like to see, as everybody wants to see themselves when they're reading for sport. When we're reading for education, we're happy to acquire information. And certainly there's a lot of information in The Right to be Cold, but I'm mostly attracted to the narrative sections of the book where she tells me about aspects of life that I know nothing about, and therefore develop a love for as a result of her being so open about her process as a woman, as an activist, even though I know she doesn't call herself an activist, as somebody bringing the message of the North to the rest of the world. And I think that she does it in an inclusive way. It can be difficult because it is also a call to action, which incites in us a kind of, well, what can we do? Because we're clearly not doing the right thing at this point. But together, if we move forward and acknowledge that there is a problem, we can solve it together. And I am wearing my sealskin boots today in homage to her and in homage to the North, because I think we need to recognize that that is a way of life that is threatened by a world that has nothing to do with them in a lot of respects.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Misha. Humble, the most inclusive book in your mind on this list.
Can we include books that are already out, or are we talking about...
You can, just not your own would be the ideal. Yeah.
I mean, inclusive, I feel I had a lot of conversations with many people in terms of, you know, we want diversity. A lot of times we look at diversity as a superficial thing, what we can see, what we can hear. But we sometimes don't talk about diversity of life choices, diversity of thought. Definitely Twitter wasn't showing a lot of celebration to that yesterday.
How do people don't read the tweet and leave? Don't come back and read the comments.
Tweet and leave. That's one way to live your life.
You know, it's in terms of most inclusive, I like the fact that Company Town shows me a diverse set of people, both on an ethnic level, both on career choices. It's the one book that has normalized sex workers. Also on an economic front, you have characters who are on in every tax bracket. And I feel like these are some of the things that are going to be important. We're going to deal with some of our racial issues over the next couple decades, and the economic issues are still going to be here. So I do appreciate that. And that is to say, because I couldn't talk about my own book.
Well, that's good. I mean, that's the objective of that question. I'm going to ask you another question. Now, Jody, yesterday you argued that nostalgia shows us that it is impossible to escape our past. So how can the remaining books on the table help us learn from the past? Misha, can I ask you that?
Well, I think in a book like Company Town and Nostalgia, where you're dealing with, you know, aspects of the future, you can hypothesize about what could potentially happen, which is a really nice space to go in because it creates dialogue. Mm-hmm. That being said, 15 Dogs also gives us a window into a new consciousness that we see from birth into its own expansion and, spoiler alert, destruction, and how that all plays out. And that is an object lesson for us as humans. And I love my Company Town because it's the book I'm representing. And I feel as though the consciousness that is raised through playing out a complete universe that could happen in an unlikely place, in a scenario that is entertaining and original, allows for a dialogue that hangs on the hanger of, you know, also a good book. So I think if we're talking about, you know, good books and what we choose to do with our free time, you have to take into consideration the entertainment factor as well.
Sure. So which book, other than Company Town, would be the one that helps you learn most from the past? I know you didn't want to answer that question. I heard that in your answer, and I want to put it to you, plain and simple.
I think 15 Dogs and Nostalgia combined are the perfect book.
Okay. All right. How do you like that?
Collaboration.
All right, Candy, can I have you weigh in on that? What book, which remaining book on the table, helps us learn from the past?
It's so good that you said which remaining, because obviously the break was
obviously
the best of that. But putting the break out, then The Right to Be Cold does it, because she also... These other books are in a fantasy world. Jody talked about nostalgia, you know, where race and identity are set aside. That is not the reality that I live in. I am an Indigenous queer woman, and I can't set any of that aside, nor am I going to be able to set that aside. So when it comes to healing, there is a great quote by author Daniel Paul, who's a Mi'kmaq author from the East Coast, who says, "Canada can never come have peace until it comes to grips with the sins of its past." And now that the break is out, The Right to Be Cold is the best book to demonstrate how much past activity impacts on today and how we can learn from that and hopefully try not to continue to perpetrate those same mistakes over and over again.
Sure. I mean, Jody, you're defending a book that has a very strong connection to the past, Nostalgia.
Right.
What would you say about that?
About what she said?
About what she said, or about your book. If we want to take it to your book, everybody seems to be pretty connected to their books, and it's hard to escape that.
Misha said, the thought came in and left my brain. But I think, and what I was saying with nostalgia is less that identity is put aside, but I found what Humble was hitting at. The rich and the poor becomes the clear difference between the peoples in nostalgia. So, you know, that seems to be, I'm a geek for history, and it always seems to be, a larger or more prosperous society will try to dictate to those around them how they should live, mm-hmm. and or how their direction should go. Right now we have, the Americans were trying to dictate democracy on certain countries, and hasn't worked out so well. We have, and in the case of Right to Be Cold, that is a history that will continue to grow, right? I mean, 100 years, we'll still be talking about climate change. So we, you know, the people from in 100 years can look at what we're doing now, read The Right to be Cold, and see this is a clear marker of where things were 100 years ago. Mm-hmm. And they can learn from mm-hmm. Sheila's message.
Chantal, what do you think about that? In 100 years, we'll still be talking about climate change and that this is a marker for that?
Well, we will, except that we'll be looking back and we won't get a chance to repeat. Like, we can mm-hmm. repeat Yugoslavia, we can repeat Somalia, we can repeat Darfur, we can repeat Afghanistan. We right. can
well, God forbid, but yes, true, fair point.
But we won't. Right. No, but we can. We can compete. We can continue with these atrocities, and they'll just repeat yeah. and look very similar. Climate change will not. We have 4 to 5 years right now to truly make a difference. Otherwise, it's not going to look anything the same as a repeat in 100 years. But the thing I would like to say about this idea of looking into the past through these books is, yes, there is absolutely not a better book in my mind than The Right to be Cold, to give us an opportunity to learn from our past mistakes, for sure, both on the level of our author, our voice is an Aboriginal hero. So she teaches us about our failures to the Aboriginal people, but also in the sense that we're going to learn what went wrong with the environment through that culture. But, you know, I want to give props to 15 Dogs on that level, because I feel like it's a great way, it's a great read in the sense of you put us inside a dog and the sins of our past and our consciousness, it's just, it's holding a mirror up to us in a it's a stark mirror. It's a stark reflection mm-hmm. to see us through a dog, because a dog we've looked at as being so innocent in everything.
Sure. I'd like to let Humble soak in the afterglow of that compliment. And Misha, you wanted to weigh in on something.
I only wanted to say or bring up the point that as we're looking at a memoir compared to, you know, different universes created, I think that the instinct to create a call to action has to be an ever organic changing one. If you look towards the future and you have authors that are hypothesizing about the future and you have, you know, what would happen inside the consciousness of a dog, I think the snapshot of Sheila's life is a very important one as an archival document to have. Because even now, she started Sheila Watt-Cloutier, the movement of connecting climate change to the human dilemma that it creates. And people have gone on to continue suing large business and governments for not mm-hmm. cleaning up their messes. But that work is ongoing. That work is happening. And I'm thinking about how it compares to the other three books. Of course, how it compares to Company Town, who takes us beyond where we are to where we could potentially be on the further, the easternmost tip of the country, where conceivably, there would only be land that is livable.
Got it. Okay. In the interest of time, Humble, I will turn to you for a final point on this question, which was how can the remaining books on the table help us learn from the past?
I think I do want to kind of point out, because everyone's being so wonderful today.
Yeah.
It's awkward. It's a much nicer swim you're having than I had yesterday, I'll tell you that.
But the show has to start. One of my favorite tweets I read today, I showed you earlier, said this competition is not about the issue. It's about which book best conveys the issue. If a book got voted out, it's not because anybody doesn't care about that issue. It's, mm-hmm. it's that we feel that that might not be the greatest weapon in the fight for that specific issue. I want to be an advocate. Again, I used to be a grade 3 teacher. You have an academic diversity as well. Not everybody has the attention span. Not everybody has the vocabulary to read every book. I am advocating for accessibility. I am advocating for the books that everyone can read, not just the diehard fans of Canada Reads who are habitual readers. I want people who have yet to find that book to make them readers get into that. And 15 Dogs touches upon every single theme addressed in all the competing books, and it does it in half the pages. And it takes it mm-hmm. one, yeah. it's 170 pages, and it does it okay. with such accuracy. It does it with such precision, and that's the reason it's so celebrated by its peers, and it's winning the awards, because it's doing it at that level. And I really hope that not only does it win this competition, but it sets a tone for next year that we have deeper rooted books where we're not simply looking at one issue books. Because what about the issues that didn't get addressed in the book today? What about the LGBT community that don't have enough representation in these books? What we need to do is we need to talk about the human experience, because that explains why we have climate change. That explains why we have economic disparaging. That explains why our First Nations people are still going through all the horrific things that they're going through. And it's because we're not understanding ourselves and we're not understanding the world around us. And the only book that does that helps us explain that are 15 Dogs.
Okay.
Two things really quick.
Interesting points from all of you.
It doesn't talk about women. A, it doesn't talk about women. And B, we are not your First Nations people.
When you say your, do you mean Humboldt?
When people say our First Nations people, we are not owned by Canadians.
Is that the only thing you heard from that whole speech?
I don't think it's an ownership issue.
And the most described, it's a very common linguistic thing that people do. Can I reply to
And I
the,
always
to the
try
woman?
To educate. And sure. I know Humboldt would never be saying that from a perspective, but it's a way to educate all the people.
I'm going to let Chantal jump in, and then you may have two things to respond to.
Yeah.
Chantal, you know you wanted to come in here.
Okay, yeah. I have 2 points here. One is that you prefaced your debate moment by saying that you were a third grade teacher and you wanted an accessible book. I started reading this book, and within 10 pages, it was too mature for me. I mean, I don't know if there's like, I would never let my sons read this book. I have 3 sons. It was all of, like, I can't say the words on TV that are in the book. If I can't say the words that are on TV, that are in the book on television, it is not a book for everybody. I'm sorry. And secondly, we won't need to talk about LGBTQT. We won't need to talk about Indigenous people, First Nations people, Aboriginal people, Inuit people. We won't need to talk about any issue on the planet at all if we do not address the problem of climate change. And I think that the way that Watt-Cloutier speaks about climate change by coming from the heart first and then introducing these very difficult topics, sorry that they're difficult, but they're still repeatable on television, is the way to do it, is the way to come at it, by inspiring us first and then hitting us with the reality check of the science.
Okay, that is, I mean...
Two wonderful critiques on the book.
Right. I want to give the final word on this section of the debate. We have more debate coming up, let's get
First, to address your wonderful point about women representation, I'm the one human character that gets the most page time in the book is Mira, who is a wonderful, dynamic female character. She shows us both her power and her vulnerability. She taught me how to approach an intimate and unique relationship, the one that she creates with her dog. At the end of the day, the most conniving characters in the book, the manipulative dogs, the self-serving dogs, the violent dogs, are not females. One of the female dogs is killed trying to help another dog.
Spoiler alert.
Well, it's going to have to go if it doesn't have good male characters.
I didn't pick a book that looks like me, sounds like me, represents any type of minority that I might check off on the box. I picked a book that represents me to my core. Everybody in this room has regrets, anxieties. Everybody in this room is struggling with the thoughts in their head. Which one should they believe? Which one should they not? Everybody in this room struggles with jealousy, irrespective of their race, their gender, their orientation, their economic background. This is the only book that talks about that over and over again. And when I talk about accessibility, I come from the digital world. I'm talking about attention spans, and I'm also talking about the fact that we might be getting a little too politically correct, and censorship has closed us off to hearing ideas that exist outside our echo chambers, that exist outside our comfort zones, and growth only exists in our comfort zones.
Okay, a lot to digest there
it's still too mature, the first part of the debate.
I want to move on. We'll have more chance to talk about a bunch of... those issues and related issues before we tackle the next book or the next question. We do have something special for you. We asked some of the biggest supporters in your lives if they had any words of encouragement for you. Uh-oh. Who's now?
Hey, Chantel, it is Sam Nutt here, one of your bestest girlfriends. You are godmother to our son, Reese.
Go, Auntie Chantel.
Between us, we are mothers to 4 boys, all roughly the same age. This is for their future, too. So don't lose hope, don't lose faith, and keep plowing through because you're such a great defender of so many important social causes. So keep going, sister, because we're rooting for you.
Misha, it's Jeff Embleton, your BFF. When you hear this, you're probably in the final stages of marshaling your prodigious persuasive powers, likely also plotting the demise of your fellow panelists. Now, one thing I know, having spent many, many nights in the basement of your parents' house playing thousands upon thousands of games of Scrabble, is that you are a fierce competitor and that you are laser-focused. I know you got this.
Hey, this is Lily, a.k.a. Superwoman and Humble. You're one of the smartest people I know. And you're good-looking, and you've got the best beard here. So get it done. I'm cheering you on. Get this W, and we'll celebrate over so much junk food.
Lily, sing!
Hey, broski, it's your little bro, Corey. Time to pull up your prosthetics and kick some keisters, man. No disrespect to them, of course, but they don't stand a chance once you're determined. Time to get pumped up and drop it like it's hot on these pylons.
Oh my God, Lily's so good.
All right. That was Auntie Chantal's close friend, Samantha Nutt. That was Misha's childhood friend, Jeff Emberton, New Brunswick in the house.
Yes.
Humble's cousin, Lily Singh.
Oh, she's not
and,
my cousin.
Well, co-collaborator.
She's my collaborator. And she just dropped her book today, How to Be a Boss.
Her book
I'm
today.
Plugging it.
And Jody's brother, Cody Middick.
Corey
Middick.
Yeah.
And who I met the other night. Obviously, there's no need to do a genealogy test. You guys are clearly brothers. Both quite intense, quite competitive. I'm Ali Hassan, and this is Canada Reads on CBC Radio 1 and Sirius XM, and I'm still waiting for my encouragement. Mom, just kidding, she called last night. Let's get back to the debate. Let's talk about this. Humble argued that 15 Dogs lets us know ourselves. So which book is least effective at accomplishing this? I'm going to ask you, Jody.
Ooh, least effective. I think they all touch on very human aspects of, as Humble continues to say, the human condition. The least. I don't know. You know what? As much as I loved 15 Dogs, I actually had a hard time identifying with the way that the characters were developing with, you know, the so-called human intelligence. And the flip side of Humble's argument, I've owned dogs and I know I've been around the world and met a lot of people, and these were vicious, very basic characters that we were dealing with. The only ones that seemed to evolve, Benji, who was, you know, just a sneak anyway, and by the end, Prince, who managed to live the longest, I suppose, touched on what it's like to be human, but. Yeah, I'd probably put the critique on 15 Dogs.
All right, let you respond to that, Humble.
I think in terms of when I was a school teacher, we would ask, you'd have C-level questions, B-level questions, and A-level questions. So C-level questions would be the what and the when. Where is the story taking place? Who is the main character? And then your B-level questions would be why. Why might Benji be a sneaky guy? When you get to the A-level questions, that requires you to dig in a little bit deeper, and that's when you say the why might, or how might. How might Benji react when he's in a different situation? And I think I looked at this book from that deeper level, and that's when it began to connect with me with what I was going through. And I wasn't thinking about, is this the way dogs are supposed to act? What I was thinking about is, this is so interesting that I'm experiencing the human experience through a creature that has heightened senses. What would it feel like, you know, my main sense is my sight. But these animals, their main sense is their smell. It's their hearing. You know, Prince eventually gets old. He has trouble seeing, and he has to navigate himself using different senses. And I always felt like that's what took this deeper. And when I see and have been reading the same critiques of the book, and I feel like that is the continual critique is because we just didn't take a journey a little bit deeper into the book. And once I went deeper into that level with this book, I started doing it with the other books. And with the exception of The Break and some elements of The Right to Be Cold, in the narratives, it became, you know, the beginning, middle, end, problem, solution. And I felt like I was watching a movie. And some movies have these deeper underlining themes, and some don't. And that's where the question is, what is a powerful woman? When we talk about Company Town, is a powerful woman someone who knows a martial art and kicks butt? Or is it The Break, where a woman keeps dealing with so much stuff and keeps getting back up?
What really is a powerful woman?
And we kind of figure out that way.
Just in terms of you having brought up the female character of Hua, and I wouldn't necessarily say that Hua's defining characteristic is that she is a martial artist, because like all people, no one is one thing. That might be the most impressive thing because it seems the most kick buddy, but let's not forget, totally a word, let's not forget that in our society it's so much easier to herald somebody who can wield violence and pain as opposed to somebody who offers comfort and sensuality. And both Hua and the legalized sex workers in Company Town sell their bodies for money, which I think does more to highlight the fact that capitalism makes victims of us all than the fact that a female has to take on male characteristics in order to be interesting. That's not true, because Hua is the survivor of abuse. She is somebody who makes her own way in a world that wants her to change all of the time. I know that people have come up to me and said how represented they feel in Company Town, because it's, first of all, set in a very original place. And I don't think that being entertaining in a novel or cinematic in a piece of literature preempts you from being good. I think this grand cause of literature as something that needs to be, you know, something recited from the lofty hallows of, I mean, this is the opera singer talking. I need something that I can relate to, and I need something that I can swing on the plane that's going to make me feel included.
And I found that in
Company Town, and I think it's a really great way to engage readers if you're looking to create new audiences, which is obviously what we're always doing in classical music. So it really, really spoke to me that way.
So that was your response to that about Hua. The question, if I can go back to it, was which book is least effective at letting us know about ourselves?
Well, I have a hard time getting to the message of how it relates to me when I... It's a difference between... Because memory is university and nostalgia addresses that. Climate change is something that affects us all, but the method by which it's given to me is something where it's literally a sleeping pill in book form. And then 15 Dogs is, I don't relate to dogs, but I am a human. So I can get in there, but then I'm always making judgment calls because I don't know if it's how I would react if I was suddenly unconscious, then conscious. Right. Do you know what I mean? So I think we've all got shortcomings in all of our books, but and however, I stand behind mine because that's what you're paying me to do.
Sure. Am I paying you? I didn't realize that.
I really believe in it, of course.
Oh, you're getting paid? Hello.
That was a creative use of words there. I don't believe you are being paid at all, but I'm going to look into that for sure. Because if she's getting paid, a lot of us will have
paid
some questions.
The way, you know, Humble's getting paid by Alexis.
Paid in knowledge.
Yes, yeah, knowledge and
so
dog
many
shirts,
compliments although. And tweets.
Can I turn that to you, Candy? The question was, which book is the least effective in getting us to know about ourselves?
Absolutely. I am still buzzing over just hearing Lily Singh's voice, and I'm sure some of the students in the room, Humble Poet and Lily Singh, Ivy, Ivy, I, played the death out of that all summer, so that was incredible to hear that.
Thank you.
And I'm still fangirling.
Has it also kept the marriage together, like that. Chantel's?
We'll
perform it.
Yeah,
you can defend her
later,
book but, next year on Canada Reads.
But for me, the two books, because I think there's two of them that for me do that the least, and it's Company Town and Nostalgia in terms of having any internal thought process. 15 Dogs, I am a dog person, full disclosure. I had three dogs, and a week and a half ago, one of our boys, Chopper, passed on. And so reading 15 Dogs became a little bit hard for me. I was kind of almost pissed off at the book because I couldn't read about another dog dying. But if you are a dog person, you do see how they have so many personified ideas about them, the right to be cold. I think everybody can reflect on their own experience when reading about Sila's experience. For nostalgia, for me, it was very male-dominated book. I have to say, if I'm being absolutely honest, the author spoke at an event we were all at and said some really hurtful things about Indigenous people, and that really impacted my reading of the book. So for me, I couldn't relate there. And in Company Town, it was, I was so hopeful because I was like, oh my goodness, it's, yeah. And I kept saying to my wife, you have to read this when I'm done. You have to read this when I'm done. But I felt like, and sometimes this happens in movies where like, oh, it's really going, it's going. And then, oh, it they lost it on the ending. And for me, Company Town at the end, it was like, oh, now it's just like a love story. And yeah, she, as Humble had mentioned earlier, her, you know, she, her life was saved because she had unprotected sex. And it's right. Like, just so much lost me at the very end. So I couldn't have, I need to respond to that.
Well, let me allow Jody to respond to that, just because that was specifically about nostalgia. And then Chantal, we'll get to you as well.
Throw in some shade on Company Town.
Yeah, yeah, there was shade thrown. And it's a lot of, that's part of what this is.
I wasn't at the event. I'm not sure which one you're talking about. You know, I suppose if you look at the personality of the author and if that impacts you, of course, it's going to affect how you would read a story. But this isn't necessarily how about your personal feelings. This isn't a personal event. A book getting voted off has nothing to do with you. This is a contest.
But how you perceive characters, I think for all of us, comes from our own feelings. So
100%. No, that's what I'm saying.
Some of the characters if
the author puts you off, of course you're not going to want to look at his work, his or her work, and give it any credit for what it's capable of. You know, I think what MG did in this book is that he tried to take out all the things that are used today to separate us and put in the fact that no matter what color you are, what your sexual orientation, what side of the tracks you're on, the biggest thing that seems to divide us as humans is economic division, right? There's always going to be the rich and the poor. And I think his main thing was, regardless of the advancements and how much you can say that you're a civilized and advanced society, you still have the wrong side of town. And then also you still have the fact that others are not going to be as prosperous as you are. So again, you know, like there's a lot of discussion about, you know, it seems like you're taking some things personal in this, and I can understand that, but I'm here to debate, you know, the merits of stories and things like that.
But on that very argument, not all people would agree that economics are it. I think there's a lot of people who walk through this world that would say, yeah, that's that. For me, it's the fact that I'm a black man, or it's the fact that I'm wheeling in this wheelchair. And also, there is also a parallel line that runs with economic disparity and some of those very differences that Jody just referred to. And I don't think they
could be. But even within those groups that you want to mention, there's going to be rich and poor. Right.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, for me, looking at it, that's the thing I really took from it that I appreciated, is that he tried to take everything else that we talk about that makes us different and talk about the fact that, you know, there's rich and poor, and that's the biggest divider
in the future.
We're talking like, a couple of years.
Misha, please hold. Chantal hasn't had any chance to weigh in on this particular issue. Chantal, you have some things you'd like to contribute here.
Yeah, I mean, can you just kind of get me back to
The original question was, no, absolutely fair, which book is least effective at letting us know about ourselves?
I mean, I think 15 Dogs, as much as it was harsh to me and it was mostly a male perspective, and I found it a little simple in terms of like, okay, we want to kill, we want to have sex. I don't know, I found it a little bit one-dimensional, but it did reveal, like Humble said, you know, the insecurity parts and the jealousy parts and the need for control, and you know, that was all in there. I would say that the stories and the story and nostalgia is too personal to Dr. Frank, and the story in Company Town, it's too much like a soap opera to me. Like, to me, it was like a futuristic, you know, Young and the Restless. By the end, I was just like, I don't know. I just found it like I could almost see bad acting with it or something. Like, those two stories did not make me feel like I was in them personally, as a human being. And 15 Dogs does accomplish that for me, absolutely.
Okay.
So, yeah. That's
all right. We have about 2 minutes till the vote. Yeah. So, Misha, I know you've been wanting to chime in, and then I want to give everybody, you know, 15 to 20 seconds to get some last points in before we vote.
All I want to do is address the neatly packaged bow ending that people seem to think Company Town ends in. Hua, all of her friends are murdered. Madeline Ashby has dedicated this book to the missing and murdered indigenous women because even in the future, we can't conceive of a society that could protect its own women and that could protect the sexualized women, mm-hmm. the sexualized women. And despite the fact that in this future, we can heal diseases in our blood before they even happen. And in this future, the Catholic Church recognizes queer marriage, even between sex workers. It's a utopic future. There is a middle class in this future.
Okay.
And I think that we have to consider a book that an aspirational book, as well as, and you can't oversimplify it.
Okay.
You're oversimplifying Hua, and you're oversimplifying the world that Madeline Ashby
Noted,
has created.
Misha, we have 1 minute left before we go to a vote. 10, 15 seconds, last comment. Candy, let's give it to you, your last comment.
Just there's been a lot of people saying I'm taking it personally. I think everyone, if they're honest, you're a person, so you do take things personally.
Yeah.
And also, I think sometimes different people exude emotion in a different way. And if you're someone who doesn't exude, you'll say, "Oh, you're taking it personally," because okay. you're not an emotional person. I'm an emotional
okay.
person.
I'm going to turn it to Humble.
I don't want this to turn into a hierarchy of suffering. It's not whose problem is more important
you.
Than the other.
Thank you.
I think at the end of the day, every book is asking us to care about something specific. All I'm saying is this book is teaching us to care.
Very valid
we can
point.
Choose what we care about,
All right.
and that's
I've
okay.
I've got to turn it to Jody. Last point that you'd like to make, 10 seconds before we go to vote.
Last point I'd make is, you know, take it for what it's worth. Nostalgia is, in my opinion, it's a decent path of possible future that we
okay.
could have in
Chantal,
our country.
10 seconds.
The right to be cold is still the one that can touch all these issues, but is truthful. It is truthful, and
okay.
it's an inspiring story.
Thank you, Chantal.
From an Aboriginal hero.
All right, that is it. That is our debate. Yeah. It wasn't going fast, and then it was going fast. It is time to vote. So, panelists, please grab your ballots. And you know this from yesterday, mark an X beside the book that you want to eliminate from the competition.
I've changed my mind 3 times today.
Which yeah. title will be voted off today? Will it be Company Town by Madeline Ashby? Nostalgia by M.G. Basanji? The Right to be Cold by Sheila Watt-Cloutier? Or will it be 15 Dogs by Andrea Alexis? The book will join The Break, which was eliminated yesterday. All right, well, a lot to think about, you guys. There was moments there where we thought we were going to hug it out. And then we took a turn. Which I would have never done because, Chantal, I don't want you to not be involved
That's
in a group
right.
hug. So there's no hugging going on. But it felt good, and then there was shade, and then there were good
there
points. And then... I think you guys all got out. That's what we're doing.
We talked about this last night, you know. That's the best part about our side of the world is we settle our differences usually with words.
I mean,
you know, and
Jody,
I've been to the places where they use AK-47s.
You know, we are fighting.
This is an amazing part of the world.
We are fighting about books. It's a beautiful thing about this country, and it should be celebrated. And that's
and
why
that's
democracy is a cherished
you,
thing that we have in our country.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. I absolutely agree with that. I think we all agree with that point.
Yeah.
I want to say hi to the people who are tuning in. We have listeners from California all the way to Newfoundland and all over this country. Annapolis Valley, Stony Creek, Peterborough, Ancaster, Castlegar, Saskatoon, Prince Albert. We have people writing in from all these cities.
Awesome.
And it is wonderful to hear that because that's the idea, you know? Get out there, get the word out. We didn't become
Are you
one
ever nervous this is going to be like the Oscars and they give you the wrong envelope?
A little bit. I'm not interested in going the Steve Harvey route personally. I want to be error-free here, but the team does good work. And it looks like they did it again today. So Humble the Poet, how did you vote?
I voted very hastily, and the last words that came in my head was what Chantel said about soap opera and bad acting. I voted Company Town.
Ooh.
Company Town, one vote against Company Town. Okay.
Misha
Ruger-Gossman, how did you vote?
I voted for readability, so I voted against The Right to be Cold.
All right. one vote against the right to be cold. Chantal Kreviazik, tell us, how did you vote?
I felt like nostalgia just today, it didn't have much punch compared to the other books. Misha was defending Company Town well, and Humble, you really defended 15 Dogs well. I voted against nostalgia today.
Nostalgia. So, to recap, we have three separate votes. One for the Company Town, or one against the Company Town is the better way to say that. One against the right to be cold, and one against nostalgia. Jody Mittick, how did you vote?
I voted for 15 Dogs.
For 15 Dogs. All right. Well, okay.
No,
this is where the
situation.
The
well, we will not have a tie today. No? People will be relieved to know that we will not have a tie. We have four separate votes.
Each of the
four books on this panel that were left all have a vote against them. Company Town, The Right to be Cold, Nostalgia, and 15 Dogs. Candy Perlmutter. It is in your hands.
It is.
How did you vote?
I voted for, with all due love and respect to my co-panelist, and again, I'll say what I said the other day, if we were voting on the book that you wrote, that would be way different. But in terms of the book he's defending, I voted on Nostalgia.
Nostalgia. Ladies and gentlemen.
But I think everybody should buy your book as
well. Nostalgia is eliminated.
Right in the field.
But that's no joke. Jody did write an incredible book that even though
right,
you might
so
say you're
actually,
not a soldier, you
with
could
this 1 minute left, I would love to get Jody's opinion on this. We have 1 minute before.
1 minute.
We are,
I mean, again, this is a debate and it's a competition, and I take nothing personally that's happening here. I think they're all amazing stories about, you know, specific things and directions in this world. And you win some, you lose some. And I'm just honored to be here. On CBC Reads, talking to everyone that you mentioned is listening in and having a chance to meet Candy and Humble and Misha and Chantel, because where else do you have this opportunity to engage with your fellow Canadians at such a broad level?
Absolutely. Yeah. I can't really answer that. It's about 1.6 million people who tune in, and it's a wonderful thing.
The CBC is such an important part of this country, and it binded us as a nation 75 years ago when it was made.
Right.
He's definitely getting paid.
We would have considered that butt kissing, but it's at the end.
I am a diehard Canadian, and I love this country so much.
All right. You know what? On that note, we have to go. That is it for Canada Reads today. Oh, we have 30 seconds before the end, so I don't know why I rushed you out.
I want to point out that Jody's one of those people who doesn't even have to say it. He's proven it over and over again.
Sure.
One of the smartest men I've met.
And that is Humble gaining favor with Jody right there.
And he voted 15 Dogs before
with Candy Perlmutter tomorrow.
Listen, his book is you may think you wouldn't relate. You couldn't get two people more different than he and I, but there is a nugget in there that about choices that we make in life and living on the edge that are so related to, and I think other people.
Well, that's a great message for Canada. Canada. That is another book after this is over that you can go visit today. But that is for sure it for Canada Reads today. that's 2 days down, 2 days left to go. I want to say thank you to our panelists, Misha Brugger-Gossman, Jody Mittick, Chantal Kreviazik, Candy Perlmutter, and Humble the Poet. I am Ali Hassan. Thank you for joining us. We will see you tomorrow. Until then, read on, Canada.
because we're no longer on the confines of the broadcast.
Yes.
You thank us every day, but let's hear it for Ali.
Oh, that's cool. That's sweet.
And also this really incredible crew here that puts this
good
whole thing together.
Yeah, absolutely. I save those thank yous for day four because the crew could still screw up before
that's
and then it would be weird to thank you, right?
It's still early.
Before we start, Misha, you wanted to answer a question from yesterday, is that right?
A woman yesterday had asked me about the conflict she felt as she was reading about Hua's sexual encounter with Daniel. And I wanted to thoroughly, I don't know if the woman is here today again, but if she's
over
watching.
Here.
Oh, thank goodness. Okay, so I asked Madeline Ashby, and I recreated your question, and she provided a response for you, because I wanted you to, Okay, she said, the catching salvation as an STD issue. That was very deliberate on my part, Madeline says. A lot of horror fiction and a lot of thrillers revolve around the virgin making it to the end because she's pure and untouched. I wanted to invert this paradigm and reward Hua for being emotionally vulnerable enough to have sex. She opened herself up to the idea that she might be appreciated, that she might be safe with another person, and that became her salvation. She took a big risk and a big step forward emotionally. That's the win. And she further says about Daniel that it was really important for me that Daniel was infatuated with or attracted to Hua and respected her deeply long before she was perfect or healed or fixed. He loved her when she was broken. Does that answer your question?
Very nice. You guys should maybe exchange email addresses or something. It's rare that you stay connected day after day like that.
As long as you don't get weird, we'll be friends.
Don't get weird. Clearly there's a story there. All right, Kevin, you have a question coming from this area here.
Because there's so many students here, like myself, I was just wondering what book out of the ones that were also eliminated would you recommend to teens that are going into adulthood?
Yeah.
That is a tougher question than it sounds.
Can
because some
that?
Of these books, you get to a place where you're like, oh my God, this was going great. Oh, thank God I did Chantal, not give this to my 13-year-old. Yes, Chantal, I want you to answer that first, please.
I think that absolutely, and this is not just because I'm defending the book. I mean this from the bottom of my heart. As somebody who is an artist, as a humanitarian, to be able to give this book to a teen would be, please, please give it to any and all teens, because they can read it. There's nothing offensive or graphic or too mature for them. And it will give them that call to action that they need. You know, studies have shown that it's the kids that are able to work with and are exposed to the infirm, the elderly, children, and causes to, you know, for protection, activism. That is what actually speaks the most to a healthy spirit and a healthy mind. And I think giving kids an opportunity to expand and grow and have purpose and meaning, for me, as an artist, as a human, that's the most I can ask for when mentoring a kid or you know, being with an audience. I absolutely think that The Right to Be Cold would be a perfect choice. There was
sure.
a high school in Toronto that just voted this book as the top book of the Canada Reads books for this year. And I think, you know, that's very revealing. Absolutely, I highly recommend The Right to Be Cold for teens.
I'm going to turn it over to Candy for a second here.
Yeah, I would just say that students are not cookie cutter. Students are so diverse, just like this panel. So my hope, my recommendation would be try all five and see what turns you on, because each of these books turned each of us on. So, you know, I hate for people to start reading in a tunnel at such a young age. I'd recommend all teens try them all, see what you like, and then look for others like it.
Can I respond? I mean, I think that is a fantastic plug for Canada Reads. And I read all five, and there were some that were easier than others to get through. And I think that you have to decide what subject matter appeals to you, what you think is going to feel more like homework than anything else,
sure.
and what is actually going to entertain you and educate you at the same time. When I program concerts, I know full well that I give the medicine at the front of the program and the dessert at the end.
Right.
You know, so When I read these books in the order I read them in, I felt a real excitement at certain points, getting back to the book. And at other points, I felt like, oh my goodness, if I could just get 10 pages in tonight.
Sure.
I want to make a plea for Company Town, of course, because saying that something sounds like a soap opera is code for literature speak, the language is too simple, or the plot advances too much,
sure,
or too much happens. In my opinion, too much can't happen in a book. If I know what's happening and the journey takes me further than it would have if I have to hear the description of the blinds, then I'm really more keen to see how the characters advance. And there's a lot of advancing in Company Town in addition to the fact that you have to wrap your mind around a futuristic community.
Sure.
Not related to Canada Reads, but just helping people go through any type of change and transition. Very short book is called Who Moved My Cheese?
It's amazing, that book.
You can probably find it online. It's a great book dealing with change in general. Very simply written, hits the point. Who Moved My Cheese? I don't know
the
author.
There's animation to it now too.
You can get animation
as well. You can watch animation of Who Moved My Cheese.
You're going from high school to university. You're going from university to your job. You're going from heartbreak. Any type of change, this book is really good.
It is.
Please don't look at this like homework, but yeah, you have to read these five books plus Who Moved My Cheese.
Who Moved My Cheese is not homework.
And you know what? I'll just echo that. My role is not to have an opinion, but I will just say that I read books that I don't read. I read science fiction for this and discovered an enjoyment. I read a memoir for this, you know, and I read fiction of a different kind. You know, I don't have that same connection to dogs, and I discovered stuff about myself I didn't know. So do read them all. If you can. So another question from the audience.
Hi, I will give a spoiler warning here. So for Company Town, Candy actually sort of touched on my issue with it. Is it starts off and it seems like we learn what, you know, her illness has caused her a lot of grief, but it's also a strength in this world, and it gives her sort of this dazzle pattern advantage. And you know, as you were saying as well, you know, a lot of people are telling her to change, but her strength comes from not having changed, and that's why she's a martial arts master in the first place, is her illness. But then suddenly at the end, that's all erased. All traces of that are gone, and I wonder sort of how you reconcile the original message that seems to be who you are, and you can find strength in that with the end of conforming will lead to your happy ending.
Well, I think that it's the human element of a science fiction novel. And I think the intersection of these two styles is accomplished by Madeline Ashby because we're asking ourselves, it's challenging our construct for what a novel should, how it should end and how it should be. Because you read science fiction thinking that because it's a total fiction, they can wrap things up easily because they can. But a novel and quote-unquote literature is meant to have us asking questions at the end. So when we meet a book that that meets both criteria, it confuses us because two audiences are reading it. I don't read science fiction, not as a rule, only because I don't want to learn a whole new language. But when I did get to Company Town, here I am reading it, and I'm wondering if there's going to be an eye roll coming as I'm reading about robots, and all of a sudden there's all these human elements, which is what keeps me in a novel. And it's progressing forward. Now, Hua does not have it sunny at the end. Let's not forget, all of her friends were murdered. Some of them she saw. She's left alone. She hasn't got the body she wanted to keep. That body would have died and decayed. Some would say, why didn't she do all the enhancements in the beginning? It would have made her far more effective in her job. But others would say, the authenticity, cling to the authenticity, rage against the machine, down with the man. Mm-hmm. And then she has to create family from these people that did these things to her, but also made her existence possible.
So
it's
much murder in
up.
Canada Reads this
so
year.
Much
so much murder.
So much murder.
Mortality is definitely a theme. All right, we'll go to a question over here.
I have a question for Candy, even though I can't see her.
Oh, hello, where are you? I want to see you. Hi.
Fix that.
Hi, today you're pretty well 100% behind The Right to be Cold, almost to the exclusion of the other books. So I'm just curious to know, why did you vote against it yesterday?
Good question.
Yesterday, I had two things coming in. I had already ordered the books before I came in, but the folks that organized Canada Reads asked us to be very open to the debate and not to stick to the order that we were in. So in the debate yesterday, there was a number of good arguments made that convinced me. And then, to be absolutely honest, at the end, I'm going to lose you now, but at the end, I misread how everyone was going to vote, and I honestly thought it was going to be a five-way tie if I threw in for the right to be cold. And some of you know there was a vote that occurred online, and if there was a five-way tie, the online votes were going to make one book safe, and the break got 41% of those votes. And I thought, if I can force a five-way tie, I can get Katerina's important book one more day. And unfortunately, I misread my co-panelists and did not see those votes going the way
so
that they went.
So you're voting strategically.
Yeah, that is a part of Canada Reads as well. Strategy versus going with your heart.
Oh, I'm not. It's going, not a criticism.
Yeah. Oh, no.
I think
and I'm not saying it is. I'm
is
saying
the way
just
to,
you know, to your question, there's so much going on in the panelist's head.
And in fact, when I ordered the books, I had 15 dogs at the very end. And when Humble went on cue and talked about, because I said, how could, if I wanted to defend 15 dogs, how could I say this is a book all Canadians have to read? I could not think of a way in which and I'm a dog person. But when Humble made the argument about fundamentalism, that pushed that book up 3 points for me. Like it made it go from last to third.
Ken,
so I try to stay open.
So we have
to that.
4 minutes. So I just today it's an anxious crowd to ask questions, mm-hmm. which is great. Not anxious. That's the wrong word. But you know, excited. We have a question back here.
I have a question that can apply to all of the panelists. So why did you choose to represent your books, and what does it mean to you to be on Canada Reads?
Nice question.
Well, I can say quickly that for me, Canada Reads is something that I have watched competitively. I kind of chuckle when Jody said, you take this personally. I was like, oh my God, if you see me when I watch it, I get like, I am texting the panelists, I am texting the host. I love TV. Yes, I love this program, and I think it's amazing that we celebrate Canadian books because we are so inundated with American culture all the time, and this is like a moment where we're all really getting into Canadian culture, and I really, really love that, so I was thrilled to be asked.
I had repeated conversations with Anne, the senior producer of the show, and everything was just so organic. Everything here, she just kept talking to me about books, and I kept telling her what my favorite books were, and then she just sent me a list, and then she sent me a bunch of books to pick from, and it felt from the beginning it was organic. They were encouraging me to pick something that actually excited me, and when you spend a lot of time in Hollywood, their priorities aren't always in alignment with what we have here. So I loved how Canadian this felt. I love the fact that if my book was to be voted out, I would still have a voice on the table. I love the fact that if my book wins, at the end of the day, all the books win, because there's no prize for us to do. The prize is us having this fun. And as well, if you ask my close friends and any women in my life, I love to debate. So to be able to do this professionally is fun.
She'd asked all the panelists, so I want it. Chantal, do you have a quick answer on that? We have about 2 minutes to play with before we go dark.
I loved that this was going to be just kind of like what Humble said for me. It's just like a little bit of a detour from the norm of what I do every day as a mom, as an artist, and give me an opportunity to read something that I would really connect with. And then as I dug into various books, I was so excited about Sila, about her life. I couldn't believe that I didn't know about her, and I didn't know what, you know, happened to her as a child, and I learned so much about, you know, my ancestral history, and I learned so much about culture.
Right.
And
I want to give Jody and Misha. I'm sorry, give me your last.
With the climate issue, I was very, very, very excited to be.
Of course, Jody, what inspired you?
I chose my book, and I kept touching on the theme of your past and reinventing, because, you know, it's not a secret. I stepped on a landmine. Lost my feet, and my entire existence came to a halt. And Jody Mittick, the soldier for life, as far as I was concerned, was gone, eliminated without my choice. And I found the characters in here, they had, some of them could choose to recreate themselves, and they did, and some of them were recreated without their knowledge. And so I kept going back to this book, and during the debate, I didn't bring that up because I didn't want to insert my personal reasons into it and try, you know, and muddy the waters with that. But I kept coming back because I was like, what would I have done if I had this opportunity to enhance my body and recreate what I was? Would I go right back to that moment before the landmine And often I say no because, you know, I have daughters now and my life is better. Here I am. Like, I wouldn't be here today, right? Mm. So anyway, that's why I picked my book.
Okay, excellent.
I came in late to the game. I had fangirled all over Madeline Ashby on Twitter prior to Canada Reads giving me the call to replace who had picked Company Town. And I read Company Town first, and then as I opened each subsequent book, was really grateful for the fact that I was reading it with the lens of defending the book that I had read first and that it held up against the other books. That was a real relief for me because you don't want to be like, well, the book is really great because I'm here to do this. But I'm a Canada Reads retournee. I'm the first loser to come back to Canada Reads. In 2004, I defended unsuccessfully Alice Munro's The Love of a Good Woman. She has gone on to nothing.
She's doing all right.
Except for the Nobel Prize and the Gellar Prize for the third time. And I have the same hopes for Madeline Ashby.
Right. And that's a final point there. I mean, even people who go off, the authors who go off first, it doesn't negatively affect their books. There are losers, quote unquote, but it really isn't quotes. I think everybody wins at numerous different levels on the show. That is it. I am Ali Hassan. Thank you, panelists. Thank you, Chantal from LA. Thank you, studio audience. Oh, yeah.